everything that I know. Says I gotta go, tired of going solo. But I'm never gonna go there again. This is what it is, this is who I am, this is where I finally take my stand. I didn't wanna fall, but I don't have to crawl. I'm not the one with two star hands. Giving him the best of everything that's left of the life inside this man. I've been born again.
Yes, born again. Newsboys, Eddie Huff here with you on a Saturday. I don't know what day or time it is where you are when you're listening to this, but we're having fun on a Saturday morning. Dave Van Risingham, how are you, Dave?
I'm doing great, other than the Oklahoma drivers I had to deal with getting here.
All right.
We'll have to have a segment on future shows. What's wrong with Oklahoma drivers? But anyway.
Yeah, I think it's because they get their licenses in Cracker Jack boxes.
Okay.
Yeah, that must be because
yesterday you were belly aching about drivers in your neighborhood.
Oh my goodness! Yeah. Well, no, it's more like parkers in my neighborhood. You know, they don't know how to park either. So it's not good. So anyway, but Dave, guess what?
What?
We've got a special guest again today.
We
have a candidate for the 2nd District House of Representatives.
He wants to go to Washington.
Mr. Nofire.
Mm-hmm.
I hope he's got some fire
got
in his belly.
Got a lot of fire.
Yeah, okay.
We
want to introduce to you to Mr. Wes Nofire, running for the 2nd Congressional District of Oklahoma.
Well, thanks for having me here today.
Oh, Wes, it's our pleasure very much. Hey, would you introduce yourself for our listeners?
Yeah, my name is Wes Nofire, from Tahlequah, Oklahoma, running for Congress. Grew up about 30 minutes outside of Tahlequah, rural area of northeast Oklahoma. It was a great childhood experience. Had a mom and dad. They worked multiple jobs. My dad was a pastor. They put themselves through college all while raising 3 kids. So they instilled in me and my siblings a hard work ethic that if you're going to work hard, you should get rewarded for that hard work. And right now with inflation and everything going on in this country, due to the Biden administration, we're stealing the fruits of that hard work from every Oklahoman. And so it's a very important reason to send a fighter to D.C. to fight to protect for the values of rural Oklahoma.
Wow. Yeah, that's exactly. I mean, that's good to hear. I mean, it's so good to hear because we have so many people today that just don't get it. It's all about, I'm going to go to Washington, do this, and this. But they're losing the real reason that you go to Washington.
Right.
That is to represent the people that you represent.
Absolutely.
You know, anytime I hear a campaign ad where the individual talks about, I'm going to go do this, and this. You know, I'm going to overturn Roe v. Wade.
Right.
I'm going to change the tax structure. I'm going to, you know, protect the Second Amendment. I'm going to blah, blah, blah. Okay, it's a great ideal. But as a congressman, honestly, you're sent there for one reason. First of all, the first primary reason is to represent your home district.
Yep.
And I think once people lose that, we start voting for the wrong reason. And then once we vote for this big picture up here and we lose the little picture, and people do that in 50 states in all the districts that are out there, it gets lost, and that's how we lose. And if people would go back to trying to defend their local areas and winning that battle, maybe we would get it back.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's all about small government. That's where it does its best job at. I mean, you can't have a voice in D.C. from your local school board. That's why you vote on your local school board. That's where you have your reflection there of how you want to instruct the teachings of your children, and that gives the parents the control there. But the parents don't have the control in D.C., so that's why you got to have small government. And sending a representative from Oklahoma to D.C. has to be that, has to go up there and fight for the rights of the Oklahoma citizens on the direction that they would like to choose. We all know nationally there's a lot of big issues, border security, Second Amendment rights, that Oklahomans are very passionate about and how they have those rights protected. But being in D.C., it's about protecting those rights in which direction they'd like to choose. And that's where we've already taken measures from being a current tribal counselor at Cherokee Nation, being a conservative voice there, to try to get information out there and trying to protect those rights. I know one big one that we all hear about when congressmen run, we got to protect the border and build the border wall. Yeah, that's true. But what about Oklahoma possibly becoming a border state? You know, Cherokee Federal tried to bring an illegal immigration camp to Tulsa just a couple weeks ago. And so, you know, I spoke out against it from the council standpoint. Even a year ago when they were getting involved in those federal contracts in California, I said, this isn't the business of the Cherokee people. It's not the business of Oklahoma tribes to be in California dealing with illegal immigration camps. So I was afraid that they were going to bring that here to Oklahoma. And obviously they tried to do that. So after speaking out against it, I called Tulsa County Sheriff Vic Rigolato. I've known him from a long time, knew him from back when I was a boxer. He liked to be around the boxing ring a little bit. And so when I was an amateur boxer here in Tulsa, we got to know each other. And I called him up and I said, what could I do to help? You know, I mean, now, we got to make sure it doesn't happen.
Now I know why that.
Now my nose is real crooked. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, what do you know? Somebody else's nose is prominent besides mine.
He's a drugstore cowboy. Yeah. He's no drugstore boxer. Well, boxing.
That was the thing. My nose would stick out in the head mask. And like, that thing's just going to get knocked off. And so obviously it's got a little crookedness there, but I protected it well and had a very successful career. I was 20-2 as a national heavyweight ring boxer. So.
Wow. As charming a discussion that is, could we get back to the real important stuff? Yeah. For once, I'm the one who wants to hear the important stuff, and Dave's the distracted one. Yeah. Okay, so you were on the tribal council.
Right.
And you had voted or spoken your peace of mind regarding this new Indian involvement in bringing illegal aliens in.
Yeah.
And so, please continue.
Yeah, so after speaking out of that, I called Vic Rigolato, and I said, what could I do to help? And so we met up here the morning of the Tulsa commission meeting, in which they were going to have to take a vote on whether to approve that use of the building here in Tulsa. And Vic, you know, I stood behind him and supported him in standing up and speaking out against it. Citizens were there speaking out against it. So ultimately it's protecting, like you said, the rights of the citizens and working with local law enforcement agencies on this case and also other legislators that spoke out against that coming here. So obviously, you know, we got that voted down and making sure that we continue to protect the rights and the wishes of Oklahomans.
Oh, man. Praise God. Hallelujah. And amen. No, I mean, that warms my, but see, these are things we don't hear about. Mm-hmm. I didn't hear about. Did you hear about this? No. I did not hear about this. So this basically started from the Cherokee tribal.
Federal contractors. Yeah.
Federal contractors.
Yeah.
Okay. And then bled over into the Tulsa City Council?
Yeah.
Wow. So.
Well, no, County Commissioners.
County Commissioners.
Okay, which is even more expansive.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and this is exactly what we've been talking about, that it begins at a local level, local, county, and then it needs to spread to the state. Right. Mm-hmm. And this is why we've got to begin electing people that start in a smaller arena, but that have the right vision and the right idea, and then can take that same vision into a larger scale.
Yep.
So, man, praise God. Seriously, this really, yeah, man, I don't know what to say. It really speaks to what I'm talking about.
Yeah. I want to go to another thing. Rather than ask you just a straight up, what's your opinion on McGirt and stuff?
Right.
I want to ask you, give me a blueprint, bullet points. What would you say is the way forward in this?
The way forward, and specifically with the McGirt handling of it, is getting tribal leaders and state leaders to sit back down at the table, because it affects everybody, whether you're a citizen of a tribal government or not. You're an Oklahoman, and it affects you one way or the other. And so you have to have leadership from both parties to sit down and start working out those agreements to protect citizens' rights. And that's the starting point. Once we're able to start getting those leaders to sit down and start practicing good faith measures and working towards an agreement, needs to be brought out in the public so the public is aware of what they're discussing, what rights citizens have, and then get their federal legislators involved, and that way we can go to D.C. and write federal legislation. That way we can correct the wrongs that are coming out of that decision.
Okay, so you're saying we've got to build consensus. Mm-hmm. Mark Wayne Mullin sat at this table a couple weeks ago, said that the same thing. but I want to dig a little deeper.
Right.
What would that look legally?
Right.
If you had your opportunity to carve out a solution.
To carve out a solution, it would be under a compact agreement the federal government would institutionalize for the state and the tribes to operate out of. And going back to the legal aspect, compacts are the great way to look at things, because compacts, you can change them, alter them for the benefit of the citizens. So if citizens, if there's problems and how that compact's affecting them, we can always go back and change it. If you put something else in there that you're not able to change, then, you know, it becomes another issue where, like we see with Roe v. Wade, whenever the Supreme Court takes a decision, you have to wait on what the Supreme Court to rechange their decision or congressional action, which is very difficult sometimes to get things done in Congress, as we all do.
Yeah, there's so many things that the tribes have their own tribal law, and then we have state and federal law.
Right.
And there's so many of these that are now intersecting.
Right.
We had the situation with the freedmen
right.
a few years ago. That's kind of died down a little bit. I don't know if it's totally over. It's been resolved yet, but at least for now, it's kind of put aside. Then you have, of course, as you said, the McGirt decision. Of course, we've got the gaming situation, the big battle between the governor and the tribes on that, and there are all of these different issues. It would be over. Yeah, and what I want to get to, and we'll get to in a minute, about the names for, you know, mascots and things is another issue that keeps coming up. But I wish there was a way to just resolve these, because, you know, we're to be one nation under God.
Right.
Yet you've got the Cherokee Nation, the Muscogee Nation, the Creek Nation, the
Sovereign Nation.
Sovereign. Yeah, not just nation, but the Sovereign Nation, you know, the Choctaw and the Chickasaw and the So-and-a-saw and da 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 da. You know, and so it seems that, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, 40 years ago, 50 years ago, this wasn't a big issue. You know, we had our tribes, we had our state, we had our feds. Just as with everything else, we weren't this multicultural country. And when I look back, for example, the Code Breakers, for those who know or have looked into it, a big part of World War II winning in Japan were the code breakers, which were
Navajo
code breakers, okay, that the Japanese and the Germans could break the codes that the Americans were trying to use. So what they did, they just used the Navajo language that they never could break, that language, and this was our code. And they would have these Navajo tribesmen doing the code within these units. And I mean, I get goosebumps when I think about it. just the richness of just, it's such a simple thing, but each culture brought and brings such richness to our country. Right. That's what makes it so great. But it's not because Navajo carved out their own little thing, or you know, Hispanics, Asians, Black people, whatever. It's because we injected that into our country.
Yeah.
And so, anyway, but it seems as though in the last, and particularly in the last 15, 20 years, it just keeps getting greater, 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 the divide between the tribes and the nation at large seems to be becoming greater, just as it is between African Americans and Hispanics and Asians. It's just this polarization, and it's bad. What do you propose on that? I mean, have you thought about this?
I have. It's a big issue. You know, being a half-blooded Indian man, a dad that's a full-blooded Cherokee, it's something I grew up as being part of who I was. And ultimately, my dad being a pastor, and there's no difference whether you're a color of your skin or not. We're a multicultural nation, and ultimately, we're a nation of people, and we're all people.
What nation are you referring to?
United States.
Yes. Okay.
That's where we're all at here. And so, you know, my dad, his uncles, they all served in World War II. they were proud Americans. My dad's a proud American. He's proud to be the state of Oklahoma. And now we have this attempt by, honestly, the liberal agenda country with their woke ideology to divide us. And that's how they're using it to divide us.
I like to, real quickly, my favorite tribes, having grown up in Minnesota amongst the Dakota and the Ojibwe, and I come down here and I'm just stunned. Because somebody didn't get the message down here that tribal members are supposed to play the victim card every time. And that didn't happen down here. They looked at opportunity and they grew the state. Fact is, it was the tribes that led the effort to get statehood. You know, it just, it really impresses me for a people that says, no, we're going to hold ourselves to a high standard. And we're going to advance for our people and all the people of Oklahoma. And that's just me, you know, yeah, as a white boy, you yeah know, looking at them. Speak to that, because I'm sure you've run into people from other tribes, other places in the nation, and it just doesn't seem like the culture's the same.
Well, it's not. You know, one thing is, like, you know, Cherokee Nation has a very rich history. I mean, they advanced themselves in their education system by leaps and bounds than anywhere else in this part of the country at that time. You know, you had the Cherokee Women's Seminary, you had the male seminary there. And that's something that at one point in time, I think it was the only seminary or the highest level of education you could get west of the Mississippi. And that was brought to by a Cherokee Nation. So they're advancing themselves very well. And so to try to take a step back and say that we're victimized people and that we're living in oppression because of this country isn't the case. And in fact, a lot of the times, and we mentioned this about holding governments accountable. And what the McGirt decision does is you have to hold governments accountable. And they've been not being held accountable over the Cherokee Nation. We've had problems over there of corruption and illegal activities against their own members. And so that's what I fought for while sitting on the council. That's the reason why it's very important to kind of address that, even as a federal level, to make sure that the federal rights of all people are protected. The individual rights, which is what we're supposed to be doing in this country, is protecting the individual rights of an American. And we're not doing that. And it's an important thing to talk about. And it's something that invigorates me. You know, my dad has always been the leader of the family and trying to make sure we know who we are and be proud of who we are and where we come from. But that doesn't make us any different than anybody else.
That's really, really good. The other thing which relates to this is the whole thing, we discussed this a little before, and that is the names of sports teams.
Right.
And we had brought up the fact that generally changing the names from, say, the Washington Redskins, Union Redskins, or Atlanta Braves, or the Cleveland Indians, et cetera, it generally, it seems to me that it's been done more by liberal whites than it has been natives.
Right.
And because when I used to be on the radio with Pat Campbell, when we had our show here, we'd have Native Americans call in and saying that they have no issue. There's no problem with being called, you know, Redskins or the Indians or, for example, the Seminole in Florida State or whatever. And in fact, I think it was Michael that brought up the fact that Tahlequah, the
school there when I went there,
High school
Indians. I mean, we're all Indian school, but I mean, hey, that's something.
They're still called the Indians.
NSU, the state college there, is
it was Redmond. They changed it to Riverhawks now.
Okay,
right.
So my dad went to school there when he was a Redmond. Yeah. Another former chief of the Cherokee Nation. He went there and played basketball, and when he was a Redmond, and
that
I never heard
to your dad.
No, it wasn't. I mean, that's the thing is that, you know, when I was a kid, I always wanted starter jackets were big back then. Mm-hmm. And I wanted a Seminole, Florida Seminoles jacket because I wanted that Seminoles on there because I was growing up with that and that was something you wanted to wear on your shirt and on your jacket there. So, you know, we start losing our culture actually whenever you start playing that game.
Yeah, I remember hearing that what happened there when that whole thing first started, that the tribes and the school, the school was very smart. They met with the tribes and they spoke to them, and then the tribes, you know, it was more of a rights thing then. And so they basically paid for the right to call themselves the Seminole.
Yeah.
And so they got way ahead of the game early on and just paid, you know, it's like paying for the right to being the Cherokee or the whatever, you know, you know.
So. I think, you know, all minorities that play the victim card, eventually they run out of real cases of victimhood and start inventing.
Right.
Because to me, growing up in Minnesota, you know, the Minnesota Vikings, well, if you're a Scandinavian there, that's a source of pride.
Right.
You know, because we don't make our mascots things we're ashamed of or things we put down.
Or things that are weak. We're strong. So when you put a Native American as a mascot, that's a strong image. It's a strong thing to put out there. And so you get, for me, it was always a thing of pride when I was growing up, whenever you'd see an Indian mascot. Now, if something wants to use it derogatory, well, then you have an opportunity to educate them about the history.
Exactly.
That's something that the Atlanta Braves has done all too well in this country, is they took that. I know Mike's actually has worked with them heavily on making sure that's an educational aspect of it. You can be proud of it. Let me teach you about it.
Even things that were derogatory in their origin, and maybe red skin was, okay, I grant that. The top franchise in Major League Baseball is the Yankees, the most valuable. Mm-hmm. That started out during the Revolutionary War as a term of derision.
Right.
And people took it as a sense of pride.
Right.
Kind of like, you know, as Trump supporters, we call ourselves deplorables. We wear that as a badge of honor, you know. And it's a turn it around.
Right.
Refuse to be a victim.
Right.
Yeah. Once you buy into it, for example, and I'm a head somewhere where I'm going to get myself in trouble, but it's okay. I don't care.
Here he goes.
I'm too old to worry about it. But anyway, when I was a kid growing up.
Right.
Black people were called Negroes or colored people, right?
Right.
Colored
or
people.
Worse.
Or if you were colored Negroes.
Yeah.
You know, so I remember the first time I was offended, or I offended somebody calling them colored. So me, I was working at a movie theater. My parents in the military, it was U.S. military, Army in Germany. And it was during the Vietnam War. It was like 69 or 70 anyway. And so I'm helping them with the concessions over Christmas holidays. I'm helping them out. And this guy comes up and he said, "Hey, brother, you remind me of something. You know something?" And I said, "No, was he a colored guy?" I said, "Colored? Brother, we ain't been colored since Columbus landed or something like that." You know? And so, he said, "Yeah, we black, man. We black." Okay. So all of a sudden, we went from being colored or Negroes to being black. So all of a sudden, black became a sense of pride.
Right.
Right. So all of a sudden, whereas when I was a kid, if somebody called you black, those were fighting words, right?
Right.
But as soon as we accepted the derogatory term, it was gone.
Yeah.
In other words, you took the bite out of the hurt.
Yeah.
So what I always said, and I said this, you know, on Pat Show, I said, just call me nigger.
Okay.
Whitey. You know, remember Sly and the Family Stone? Sly actually came out with a song. It was 69 or 70, and it was called "Don't Call Me Nigger Whitey."
Right.
You know, "Don't call me nigger Whitey." And it was this whole thing. And he was trying to, I think that's what the whole object of the song was, showing that it's useless to do this. Okay. So, but my thing is, okay, if you call me that, you know, somebody says, "Hey, nigger, what up, Chuck?" Or "Honky, cracker," da-da, you know. But like I said, black, once we identify with it, it took the sting out of it. Remember nerd used to okie in Oklahoma? Oh, man, you didn't call somebody an okie. It was a derogatory term. But once the Nerds movie came out, Revenge of the Nerds, all of a sudden, everybody wanted to be a nerd.
Yeah.
You know, all of a sudden it meant you're smart. You're a genius. You work for IBM or something, right?
Right.
So anyway, but that's just something I've always thought. But Native American history, and we've talked about a couple of times on here, and we talked about it in the other room earlier, you know, about the Lakota, the Apache, the Crow, different ones, in the Cherokee earlier about you guys, I guess originally came from Virginia, North Carolina.
North Carolina, Tennessee.
Yeah,
area,
Tennessee, Georgia, that area. Georgia. And you guys had a rich history. You guys, I mean, you guys have always been prosperous.
Yeah.
David talked about earlier about, what's his name? Greenwood. Greenwood LaFleur.
Yeah. Yeah. The Choctaw, yeah.
Oh, was he Choctaw? Yeah. But I mean, Choctaw, Cherokee, all these, you guys came, were pretty prosperous in, before you ever came here. And they're prosperous still over in the South and in the Atlantic region over there.
Yeah.
So it's not like, you know, there's some bad negative history or something. It's all this forgotten stuff that everybody has just turned into this thing where it's all of a sudden, oh, those poor, poor natives, you know, those poor, poor black folks, those poor, poor Mexicans. I mean, you know, and this is what drives me nuts too. When we talk about, on one hand, you know, African people are so this, 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 but then at the same time, you go back and they want to talk about these African kingdoms and we come from this and from this and from this. But at the other hand, we're always talking about how poor and downtrodden. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
It's, and I don't want to take away from you or your story, but I'm just saying that this is a part of human nature, and it's done on purpose, I believe. It's done to try to create a narrative that gives somebody an advantage, and it's usually a political advantage. Oh. And with that, I want to get back to your story. So you're running for the second congressional district, and this is what I want to focus on right now, because I believe there's two things that I like about you. We've never met. Wes and Dave and I, we have never met before. But right away, I like a couple of things. One, you're youth. You're young. We've got too many old people up there. Two, you're fresh. Your background, and I want to hear about that. I want to go to this next. You're not only Native American all, but you've done some things, very different things.
Yeah.
Boxing. Okay. That has to be one of the more unusual backgrounds of any candidate that I've heard in a long time. Okay.
Yeah.
Tell us, how did that happen? I think you were telling me, you wanted to play basketball. You played basketball in high school, correct?
Yeah, correct.
And did you play in college at all?
I didn't play in college at all. I wanted to play in college. I was really hoping that I'd be able to go to Division I. I went and played.
Bobby Knight scared him off.
Well, Bobby Knight, let him get to that. I want to hear. So
went down for 2 weeks, played with Bobby Knight, down there trying to hope to get some sort of attention of a D1 school. It didn't happen. NAIA schools wanted to pick me up, and I just, it was kind of a little burnt out, so went to college just without going and playing sports, looking for some other opportunity to stay active, and I like to scrap a little bit, so I found myself in a boxing gym actually up here in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Was the first place that I walked into. And within a year of boxing, I was already at the National Golden Gloves level. Had got a phone call from a guy that I sparred with just once. He was fighting for a world title against Vitaly Klitschko in Bern, Switzerland. And so next thing I know.
So were you a heavyweight?
I was a heavyweight.
Oh, wow.
And so after that, my wife, she was a very successful business woman. She got a job opportunity in Florida. And that was the opportunity I saw as well to pursue professional boxing. And so we moved out there, and it was just very, very successful for me.
So you became a professional boxer, a heavyweight.
Heavyweight professional boxer. Ended my career with 20-2. Out of 20 victories, I think 16 of them were by knockout. Fought everyone from on ESPN, Fox News, or Fox Sports. And so I had a great time. But one of the things I was proud of with boxing, though, was actually paving my own path by creating a management and promotional company. We all know boxing has its fair share of corruption in that sport. My dad always taught me, said, never sell your soul out to anybody, not for a buck, never do. So we started it, worked with Mike Tyson and Mike Tyson Promotional Company. So it was a successful run, very successful, and had a good family behind me. Obviously led it with faith and trying to do the right things. Gave opportunities to young kids that were trying to aspire to be a professional athlete, to live the American dream. And there were times I didn't make a paycheck, but I made sure I was able to pay those young athletes who put in the work to come out and fight that night in front of their home crowd here.
Boy, I bet that's quite an experience, that whole fight game.
Yeah, it is. It is. You know, and what you're mentioning too earlier about race being when you're in a gym, it doesn't matter what color you are. You're taking punches or you're giving punches, and it's all. And afterwards, man, you earn respect of each other. And that's the thing this country doesn't have. We don't have respect for each other hardly anymore. Expect where you come from and knowing that we can go to battle together at the end of the day. We're all Americans. We all love one another.
Now, what do you do now? What are you involved in now?
So when we moved back home to start a family, I got into real estate. So I have a real estate company that worked with Century 21 down in Tahlequah. And then my sisters and I are part owners of a mental rehabilitation facility. So it was kind of a family's work there. My dad and mom opened it in 95. My mom committed suicide roughly 12 years ago. And it wasn't a gun that did that. It was her mental state of mind, even though she used a gun. That one's Tequila Behavioral Services.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, you know, that's why, you know, we have to take an aggressive look at mental health being conservatives in this country if we're going to protect our Second Amendment right. It is a freedom.
Absolutely.
And freedom comes with responsibilities. And we all know with the devastating mass shootings that's happened over the past couple of weeks that the liberal agenda is going to try to use that as an excuse to start limiting our rights to bear arms. And so we have to fight back with taking a real aggressive look at mental health. It's something that has been very forefront in our family as history to make sure that we take a look at that.
Have you been a Republican from the beginning?
From the beginning. From the beginning, I've been a Republican. Grew up, one of the first elections I voted in was in the Obama race going on there. We were seeing what was happening. I was in here in Tulsa and working with the young Tulsa Leadership Professional Program. There's a lot of Democrats and liberals there. Mm-hmm. And so I always enjoyed the arguments that we would have on
Typros,
yeah. So I always enjoyed the arguments I would have there because I would listen to you all day long, try to prove my position wrong, and I'll try to prove you why I'm right. And that's where I kind of got involved in the political world there.
How'd you end up with Mark Wayne Mullen's team? Because I understand.
Yeah, so Mike Stopp was former chief of staff of Mark Wayne Mullen's. He was one that I reached out to early on whenever we seen this as an opportunity to best serve Oklahoma. And, you know, he was like, I'm going to get involved with this. And then I sat down with Mark Wayne Mullen's with dinner, and I was looking at the name of candidates that were already making their public announcement. And I said, none of them have anything different to be able to protect the rights of Oklahomans and some of the biggest issues we're faced with here in Oklahoma, like the McGirt decision and how to handle that.
Okay.
So it's been good there. We also have a good fundraising team that's worked with Mark Wayne Mullen's victory staff. And
okay, so just to clarify for those who may not know, because we had a pre-show conversation, Michael Stopp worked for Mark Wayne Mullen. Michael Stopp is now your campaign manager.
He's now my campaign senior staff member.
Gotcha. Yep. Gotcha. Okay.
And he's sitting right over
here. And he's sitting right over here as well.
Off camera.
Yeah. Okay, great. So you weren't officially on Mark Wayne Mullen's staff.
Right. I wasn't. Yeah, no, I wasn't. Mike was. I was.
Okay. Has Mullins endorsed you?
No, he has not.
Okay.
I mean, he's got a big Senate race, and I know he's been supportive of a lot of candidates running for office, and I respect that.
Many of them are his friends.
Yeah. My sister went to high school with him over in Stillwell, so
yeah.
I've known him for a while. He's known our family for a while and know where we stand, and so he's been supportive of that.
Well, I may need to give him a call.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I'm going to say something. We were talking about endorsements, so I haven't made one yet.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't, and I don't know if I will later, but I'm going to make one right now. And I everything I've heard, I think you're the guy. I think you're what we need. We need fresh voices, fresh faces, and you check all the boxes.
I appreciate that.
Now watch. Monday, I'll read something about you.
Yeah.
Well, to reaffirm,
he's a fake Indian. Well, he's another Elizabeth Warren 2,050th percent.
You're up against several former and current state legislators,
right?
And there's maybe two of them that would still be in the running for me. Most of them, I don't want anything to do.
Right.
I think the people that I know in eastern and southeastern Oklahoma, and now your district goes from Bartlesville to Broken Bow.
Right.
Right. So it's, I think the people there really don't want a slick talking politician.
Right.
I mean, I got to know Wes Watkins a little bit, who's historically been that congressman, you know, and the last thing he would want to impress in common folks is how good a politician he is. And I ran into, you know, these are common folk.
Right.
These are salt of the earth folk.
Yes.
And I just, I think the appeal of populism is probably stronger there than anywhere else in the state.
Yeah. And when you said that, the salt of the earth, that's a big statement there. You know, whenever you say the salt of the earth, we're here to prevent corruption. That's what salt does to meat. It prevents its erosion. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're here ultimately to do. And so picking a common folk that knows that they can't be bought off is what you're going to find out with me, because you can never buy me off. You can't buy my voice. Only the people is what I listen to. And that's what reverberates out of me and the representative. And that's what the 2nd Congressional District of Oklahoma needs.
This is good. Seriously. Yeah. If you get to Washington, okay, what do you think you can do in your first term?
Well, in the first term, obviously lead in the solution for the McGirt decision and how the tribes and the states are working together. That's the first thing I can lead on there. You know, the other thing is going to take a look at...
Do you think, does the House have the ability, because isn't that more of a judicial matter right now?
No, because the tribes ultimately are held under what the United States Congress tells them they can and can't do. They are domestic-dependent sovereign nations, so they're dependent upon whatever Congress lines out that their capabilities are. So
I see, because I thought it was moving its way up through the courts.
No, there's okay. Fights going on back and forth in the courts between right. tribes and state to right. try to overturn or limit the McGirt decision.
Right.
And that's where we're having problems.
In simple terms, the crux was...
Dave, I need you to get closer to it.
The crux was that Congress did not dissolve the tribal land, if we will, as most people just presumed it had happened.
Right.
A century, we thought it was.
Right.
I mean, so Congress not acting is what caused this situation to eventually bubble up. So Congress taking the right action
right.
is key to the resolution.
Right. So basically, right now, judiciary can only make temporary fixes or right. is trying to do temporary fixes, but to really deal with it, it has to be congressional action.
Absolutely.
Okay, now I got it. Okay, great. So this would be your primary first.
That would be my primary focus right here in Oklahoma. The other thing is to also continue to protect Oklahoma rights, and that's by going up to D.C. and start working with other legislators. I know Mark Wayne sounds to be doing pretty successful in his race, and I know it's something him and I talked about trying to work on pulling the regulations out from the President of the United States and back underneath Congress, because if we can't represent the 2nd Congressional District on regulations, and we're seeing the inflation that's going up there because of the regulation interpretation by the new president that came in that's led us to this problem, Congress has to be able to retract that in order to be able to control it better.
So you're talking regarding oil and
how we'd be able to pump it. Yeah, absolutely. So...
Wow. Yeah, it's important stuff. See, this is, again, ladies and gentlemen, why we have to return the power to the local jurisdictions. And this is what is so lacking and what people are forgetting. You got all these people making promises on what they're going to do when they get to Washington about abortion, Roe v. Wade, and da, 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 da. But when it gets down to it, we've got to get back to our local jurisdictions. Yeah. Dave, you got any more?
No, I think what I heard, I'm really impressed with. I would have liked to have gotten just a little more specifics about what your proposed blueprint is for resolving. But I also respect the fact that you're not trying to impose your solution as much as listening
right.
and finding consensus.
Absolutely.
That's a good point.
It'd be
Bridges the gap.
Yeah. Wes, so if you take a minute or two, whatever you want, and if you will look at that camera right there and just kind of let the people know what you would like to tell them.
And how to get in touch with you.
Okay.
Yeah.
One thing is, Wes Nofire running for Congress. Need your vote and support June 28th. If you want to get in contact with us, you can look us up at wesnofire.com. Join our mission and our team and what we're standing for at teamnofire.com. And like I said, it's a very important race to make sure that we have all the support out there to represent you in D.C. because ultimately it comes down to you and nobody else. So appreciate you. Appreciate you guys allowing me to be here and taking the time to talk about some of these important issues.
Thank you very much. We'll be back in a few. All right, everybody, we're back. Wow, that was something. It was really fun. I was very serious on everything I said there. I really want to highly endorse this guy because we need fresh blood. Mm-hmm. Fresh blood. And he seems fresh. And his background is so different. He's very, you can tell he's conservative and he's youthfully conservative. Mm-hmm. He's Native American. He's like me. He's half and half. Half breed. You know, it used to be a bad thing, didn't it?
Yeah.
I remember a movie, somebody was a half breed Indian. You know, in those old cowboy westerns.
Yeah.
But 50% is a lot these days to be half anything.
Yeah, I'm not 50% anything. You know, I mean, I'm just such a mix. Fact is, Eddie,
Some people would say you're 100% something.
Yeah, I think
it may not be good.
There you go. Yeah.
They say that about me all the time. That Eddie Huff, he's 100%. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But anyway, but seriously, that was good. I'd never, I just got a text this week, from Mike, his, campaign manager there, who used to work for Wayne Mullin.
Yeah.
And he's a good guy. He's a West Point graduate.
Mm-hmm.
Mike was a West Point graduate.
Yeah, I've known Mike about 10 years.
Yeah.
He worked the Ron Paul campaign in 2012.
Oh, yeah,
very much a Liberty Republican. And we have a lot of mutual friends. Fun guy. Man of great character.
Yeah. He sent me a text. Would you be open to having him come in and Wes come in? And I said, yeah, sure. But I didn't know him from Adam. And it turns out he was a good guy, and I'm very, very happy that we brought him in.
Mike dropped a bombshell after we went to break, and it's a couple of big endorsements.
Are we allowed to?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay. You're talking about other people that endorsed Wes.
Yeah, surprise me.
Yeah, have at it. Let us hear.
So none other than Governor Kevin Stitt has endorsed him, and which speaks highly of Governor Stitt and Attorney General John O'Conner. Now, given, you know, he's a very loyal, committed Cherokee tribal member and a member of the council. And Governor Stitt says, I like him.
Yeah, it's interesting because Governor Stitt is not that favored by the tribe.
Even though he is a Cherokee.
Yeah, even though he is, the tribe is not that in favor of him. But you can tell that Wes, while he sits on the council, is probably not a fair-haired boy either, because he bucks them in many ways, and some of the things he told us afterwards that they're fighting against, which we'll talk about here in the future, they're going to become more and more prominent. But this is very important to people. And I'll tell you what, if we were to, say, elect him as a congressperson, it would be really a feather in our cap to have a Native American congressman. I mean, Mark Wayne Mullin is a Cherokee, but not as prominent, I would say.
Right, not a member of the tribal council.
Exactly.
And then Tom Cole is a Chickasaw.
Right.
And our governor is Cherokee.
Right, Cherokee. So you know, it would be good. You know, Indian Nation, this used to be Indian country, what it was for a long time. So, hey. Let's represent.
Another thing that came out, and I can't get into the details because it's still in the works, but the four other, quote, civilized tribes, Seminole, Creek, Choctaw, and Chickasaw, are ready to sit down to talks with the governor. The tribe that's just not even ready to talk is the Cherokees. And it's because of the Cherokee leadership, not the citizens thereof. It's a radical Cherokee leadership right now.
Yeah. Yeah, we'll see. And you know what that's all about. You know what?
Well, I can think of a lot of things. What are you thinking about?
Money.
Oh, yeah.
It's always.
Yeah.
The root of all evil. I mean, seriously, everything. Yeah. Look, when you.